Hello friends and everyone, welcome back to the series of analysis on economic survey. Today we are going to have discussion on the seventh chapter, that is a very, very interesting topic, and this also has been mentioned in the earlier economic surveys 14, 15, and 15, 16. The chapter is regulatory forbearance, an emergency medicine, not a staple diet. The meaning of this chapter is regulatory forbearance, whatever inactivity or whatever the forbearance offered by the banks or financial banks regulators, it should be like an emergency medicine. We should not continue these forbearance for longer time. It should not be a staple diet, it should not be a mundane activity, it should be a emergency activity, it should be like a medicine in the during the emergencies. That's what the meaning of this chapter. And of course, like the very beginning of the economic survey, I told that the four things are very common in the entire economic survey of this year. One is the timing, the second is learning from the past, and third is evidence based policy making, and fourth is the ethos of Dharma. The four things are well evident in this chapter, because the chapter itself started off with the quote that those who do not learn from the history are condemned to repeat it. It seems we should learn from the history and rectify our mistake and go forward. That's what the meaning of this quote, and this what has been the main theme of the lesson. This chapter is we should learn from the past, and based on the evidence which our policy should be, our policy making should be based on the evidence, our reform should be based on the evidence, and we should rectify our mistakes and should be included in the reforms, learning from the past and evidence based. So let's see first what is this regulatory forbearance. Here regulatory forbearance, here banks relaxing the norms for certain period of time for restructuring the assets. You know, the assets of the banks are loans. Loans offered by the banks are the assets of that. If these assets are not able to retain the interest or principal amount for certain period of time, maybe for 3 months, it is classified as NPA, non-performing assets. And if the time period, the non-performing assets time period increases for more than 1 year or 2 years, it will be become stressed asset and doubtful asset. So this chapter discusses thoroughly about the restructuring of assets, because the firms are not able to repay the assets because of various reasons, because of the maybe the global financial crisis or the boom and economic cycles. Cyclic changes in the economic in the financial year. So the restructuring is necessary, but not all the time. That's what the survey is try to explain. So this chapter about the adverse impacts of the, it also discuss the adverse impact of the regulatory forbearance, not only the health of the banks, not only the health of the financial institutions. It has the adverse impact on the corporate governance itself. It also leads to the deterioration of the corporate governance. If keeps on this forbearance keeps on extended for longer time, banks will suffer from the undercapitalization. They do not have the required capital. So this will lead to the deterioration of the health of the banks and also the corporate governance. So this is what, now what is policy forbearance? The first question that survey survey discussed this, what is policy forbearance. So this, in 2008 there was, as all of you know, 2008 there was a global financial crisis. This is also known as great financial crisis in the present future. So because of this global financial crisis, there was a recession across the world. So because of this recession, the deleterious effects of the recession were also felt on the Indian companies. So Indian companies and corporates are not able to repay their principal or amount. So they were at the verge of NPA, becoming NPA, non-performing assets. Since most of the assets are non-performing assets, banks also faced the problem of undercapitalization because they were not able to get the get their revenue back on their assets because of global financial crisis. So in 2008, RBI announced this regulatory forbearance that relaxed norms. Even if the asset is at the verge of becoming NPA, the RBI relaxed the norms to restructure the NPA and make it as a standard asset rather than substandard asset. That is what policy forbearance. The survey also tried to differentiate between the policy forbearance with forbearance and without forbearance. The policy forbearance in this survey, the survey also tried to differentiate, tried to discuss the differences between what could be the policy implication with forbearance and without forbearance also, without forbearance and with forbearance also. So, if there is no forbearance, even viable projects, if there is no forbearance, the projects, viable projects in the bank would be restructured. The viable projects which are facing the which are at the verge of NPAs, they would be restructured, and there will be additional, there would be restructured, and it will be declared as NPA and provision for the same. If there is no provision, if there is no forbearance, even the viable companies and viable projects and viable companies would be restructured if they become NPAs, and they will be classified as NPAs, and provisioning will be made for the same. Provisioning means banks are required to keep additional amount of money on the doubtful assets, on the doubtful loans, so that to meet the capital requirements. Provisioning is nothing but banks are required to keep additional loans, additional amount of money on doubtful loans in anticipating the future of the loans, anticipating the future of the doubtful loans, banks are required to keep some additional money. That is what provisioning. If with forbearance, yes, if the viable projects are facing the crisis of NPAs, if they are at the verge of becoming NPA, they would be restructured, but they will not be classified as NPA. They will not be classified as NPA, even the viable project, they will not be classified as NPA, and they will have the same level of provisioning as if it, as the provisioning as if it is with the, without, as if it is without forbearance. So provisioning will be same here and here. Provisioning will be same. The amount allocated for the provisioning requirement will be same even without forbearance, with forbearance for the viable projects. But this without forbearance, the restructured loan will be considered as NPA, will be considered as substandard assets. But here, it will be not be considered as NPA, but it will be, there will be provisioning. If the project is unviable, bank would not restructure the without forbearance. If the unviable project, the banks will not be restructured itself. It will be directly considered as NPA. Right. It will not be considered as NPA. Crucially, banks do not gain by restructuring that. There will not be scope for restructuring here. Without forbearance for unviable projects also, because it is more risky to restructure, because they know that for unviable projects, even if it restructuring also, there will not be any income, or there will not be any gain in the future for unviable projects without forbearance. But with forbearance, the banks are going to restructure even for the unviable project, that is the mistake in forbearance. Even unviable projects also restructured here and considered as, and will not be considered as NPA. Even unviable projects also restructured and will not be considered as NPA. So this is the adverse impact of regulatory forbearance and reducing the provision requirements also, so that it will lead to undercapitalization. So there will not be any provisioning without unviable projects also considered will be restructured and will not be considered as NPAs. Underestimate the provisioning requirement. Unviable projects also considered as will not be considered as NPAs. So there will, when there is precise and accurate estimation of NPAs, relative amount or the analogous amount will be required, will be kept for provisioning requirement. But here, unviable projects also will not be considered, will not be estimated correctly as NPAs. So that there will be less provisioning requirements. When there is less provisioning requirements, banks will face the crisis of capital requirement or capital investment. This is what this policy forbearance in India, it was introduced in 2008 in the aftermath of global financial crisis. We introduced this. So this involves the risk shifting, isn't it? The incentivizes the banks to take risky decisions, to take risky restructuring. It incentivizes the banks which are taking risky restructuring. So banks will get incentivized. And this regulatory forbearance also involves the risk shifting, because banks, how this risk shifting involves? It is shifting risk away from the promoters, equity owners of the banks, because undercapitalization and the loss should be borne by the equity holders of the bank, respective banks. But here, if you keep on restructuring the stressed assets, NPAs, and you are not classifying the NPAs, and you are inflating the profits, since you are inflating the profits and the equity holders are entitled to get the dividend, so you have to spend that money to pay the dividends, you have to spend more money to pay the profits to the equity holders or shareholders of your bank. So when you are spending more money on equity holder, more money for paying dividend to the equity holders, your bank will suffer from the capital requirement under capital. Now this capital should be borne by the government, and it is shifting from the banks equity holders to the government and the taxpayers. Now the taxpayers' money should be utilized to meet your capital requirements for capital infusion. So it not only has the adverse impact on the bank's performance, bank's lending activity, the bank's health of the bank and corporate governance, it also shifts the risk away from the equity holders to taxpayers, because taxpayers' money will be utilized to infuse capital in this. Now what is the original sin? The policy forbearance involves the risk shifting from equity holders to taxpayers and depositors. Depositors' money should be utilized for more lending, so that they will get more profit. But here, banks are underestimating the NPAs and inflating the profits, paying more money to dividends, so they face the undercapitalization, undercapital requirements. So what? They have to get additional capital infusion. For meeting the additional capital infusion requirements, the depositor monies and taxpayers' money will be used. Now, let's go to this survey, the question, next question of the survey in this chapter. Where is the original sin? The 7 years of forbearance. Where is the original sin? Where is the original sin? As per the regulations, before forbearance, the survey also tried to differentiate what was the situation for classifying asset into NPA or a substandard asset or standard asset before forbearance, and what is the now the forbearance policy says for classifying the asset into substandard asset or standard asset. So before 2008, if a non-industrial and non-SME asset is restructured, even if it is a standard asset, if before 2007, before forbearance, non-SME and non-industrial, non-SME and non-small medium enterprises or non-industrial asset is restructured, it was considered as substandard asset. Yes, it was considered as substandard assets if there is a restructuring of an asset. If there was a restructuring of asset, particularly pertaining to non-SME and non-industrial asset. But because of the forbearance policy that was introduced in 2008, even the non-SME, non-industrial asset, even if it is restructured, it is being considered as the standard asset because of the forbearance policy. The new relaxed norms entitled borrowers to retain the same asset classification upon restructuring also. Same asset classification, same substandard asset classification upon restructuring also. This is because of the new forbearance policy that was introduced in 2000. Now the accounts would no longer classified as substandard assets. Now banks are no longer required to make the provisionals. When the asset is not classified as substandard asset or NPA, banks will not be accurately allocate money for provisioning requirement. When there is no accurate provisioning requirement, when there is no proper estimation for provisioning requirements, it will lead to under capital requirements, outstanding. So it will lead to under capital requirements. Now the relaxed norms were extended to unviable, and relaxed norms are extended to already restructured loans also. That is the biggest mistake in discussed in the original sin. Even the loans which are already restructured, they were also eligible for restructuring. They were also eligible for restructuring. If you keep on restructuring, right, it will lead to evergreening of the loans. That's what PGNI committee. PGNI committee was appointed in 2014 to bring about unprecedented reforms in the banking industry. So PGNI committee identified the original sin because of the forbearance policy. What the PGNI committee identified because of the forbearance policy, because it is leading to this continuous application of forbearance policy or the prolonged implementation of forbearance policy, leading to the evergreening of the loans and undercapitalization. Like if we keep on undergoing and evergreening the loans by restructuring, banks will not be able to identify the exact amount of money for provisioning requirement. When they are unable to identify or estimate the exact money required for provisioning requirement, banks will also suffer the problem of undercapitalization. So PGNI committee identified two issues because of the original sin, that is prolonged continuation of this forbearance policy. This is evergreening of loans.
leading to the evergreening of loans, and banks also suffer from undercapital requirements, undercapitalization and evergreening of loans. These are the two issues identified by the PGNI committee. So the original sin, the 7 years sin, why we are saying that 7 years of forbearance? According to the evidence, why it is called 7 years forbearance, which is discussed in the extended, whether we should extend the forbearance or we should go for early resolution. This question has been discussed with the evidence from the international experience. This question, the solution for this question is been discussed based on the international experience, evidence from the international experience, like one of the themes of the entire economic survey, evidence-based policy making. What this international experience says? International experience shows that early resolutions to these substandard assets or NPAs, take the example like Brazil, Canada, Germany, USA, they had lower average, lower peak of NPAs. Less rise in the NPA, rate of NPA. The rate of rise of NPAs is very, very less in these countries which resorted to the early resolution. Says the survey took the examples from the Canada, Brazil, USA. These countries used this forbearance policy only for certain amount of time, only for emergency medicine, only for the temporary purpose, as a temporary measure to solve the impact of the adverse impact of the global finance crisis, they witnessed less rise of only the 3.5% rise in the NPAs. Only 3.5% of rise of NPAs in those countries. Let's take this example of late resolvers like India, which we kept on extending the forbearance policy because we are not able to resolve the issue. What we have done, instead we extended the forbearance. Ideally, our forbearance should be only for 3 years, 2011, and what we continued for even till today, forbearance policy. We continued up to 7 years, maybe 2018 and 19. We continued this forbearance policy for 7 years, 2018-19. But the countries like Canada, Brazil, USA, since the crisis, global financial crisis was in the year 2018, the forbearance policy was only up to 11 and 12. But India, it continued rigorously continued up to 2018 and 19, 7 years. Because of these 7 years, because we could not do early resolution, the average rise in the NPAs in India was 9.5%. 9.5% was the peak rise of NPA in 2015 to 19. The 4 years, 2015 to 19, the rise in the NPAs was 9.5%. In the same period, it was only 3.5%. So from the international experience, so what we can conclude is that we should go for early resolution and we should stop the forbearance policy. Rather, we should bring about some reforms discontinuing the forbearance or creative utilization of forbearance policy, right? So how the creative utilization of forbearance policy will lead to the fall in the rise in the NPAs? And now, because of the COVID-19, even the NPA rise is more than 11% because of this. So India is facing the severe crisis of rise of NPAs, rise of substandard assets in India. According to the latest report, the total value of NPAs in India is almost 15 lakh crore of the total amount of money lent. So we should go for early resolution. The survey also discussed the adverse impact of the forbearance on the bank's performance and lending practices. What could be the adverse impact? The first impact, obviously, it is under capitalization, because banks will not be able to, will not be in a position to exactly identify the NPAs. When there are no NPAs, when there is no exact identification of NPAs, banks will not be able to put the exact amount for provisioning requirement. When there is no exact amount for provisioning requirement because of the evergreening of loans, as Pease and Ike identified, it will lead to undercapitalization is the major problem, because of when there is undercapitalization, banks' lending practices would be affected. Lending targets will not be met. Right. So, and other impacts will be lending to zombie companies. Already capital strained banks are continue to lend the unviable companies, unviable projects, zombie projects, because of the forbearance. Forbearance policy requires banks to restructure the loans or re-restructure the loans or extend the loans even for unviable projects and unviable companies. These unviable projects and unviable companies, zombie companies and zombie projects, zombie companies and zombie projects, because these are unviable. It is waste of allocating, restructuring money or allocating, extending new loans to these zombie companies or zombie projects. Obviously, it will lead to the inefficiency of the banks. Like Pease and Ike committee, evergreening of loans is also one of the major adverse impact of the forbearance policy, adverse impact of the evergreening of the loans. Like in the very outset of, very beginning of the chapter, at the very outset of the chapter, it will lead to the deterioration of corporate governance as well. It will lead to the weakening of the corporate governance as well. That is why Pease and Ike committee introduced Mission Indradhanush for the seven reforms for the healthy growth of banks industries. Pease and Ike committee identified Mission Indradhanush, seven reforms. All the seven reforms are the solutions to the adverse impact of the forbearance policy. Adverse impact of the forbearance policy. And also this lead to inefficient allocation of capital by the borrowers. Not only banks face the under capital requirements, the borrowers who benefited from the forbearance policy from the banks, these zombie companies, they will not utilize this capital efficiently, because it is restructured, it is not forcing them to pay immediately, it is not forcing them to retain this substandard asset status. So it will lead to the financial indiscipline among them. There will not be financial discipline among the zombie companies who benefited from the banks. So it will lead to inefficient capital utilization from the forbearance policy. It will lead to inadequate capital requirement of the forbearance policy, isn't it? So this also beneficiaries who benefited from the forbearance also misallocate that money to, again, unviable projects. Zombie companies which benefited from the forbearance policy also, they will not only use this money efficiently, they'll also misallocate this money to unviable projects. So if the misallocation of the capital because of the forbearance is one of the adverse impact of the forbearance policy. The banks who resorting to this prolongation of structuring of the loans are because of the forbearance, it will lead to the inefficient allocation of the capital, because forbearance will also lead to the deterioration in the working of the bank boards. deterioration in the working of the corporate governance, deterioration in the bank governance practices. Because of this deterioration of the governance practices, it will lead to the misallocation or inefficient allocation of capital because of the forbearance policy. It is again based on the international evidence. It is again estimated based on the international evidence. And the forbearance policy will also lead to the misappropriation of the money, because the zombie companies or the banks which allocate this money to zombie companies or zombie projects, which will lead to the inappropriate utilization. It will be invested in the unviable projects which will not give you the revenue, which will not give you the estimated revenue, which will not give you any profit, which will not give you any dividend. So this forbearance policy will extend the practices of inefficient allocation, misallocation and misappropriation, inefficient utilization of capital by the banks. And this also lead to the deterioration in the performance of the borrowers, because there will be the lack of financial discipline among the borrowers, because they are in the hope that once our asset is gets into the substandard asset anyway, because of the forbearance, it will not be classified as substandard, it will not be classified as NPA, it will be retained the standard asset status. So the performance of the borrowers who benefited from this capital of the bank also will not be efficient performance. So there will be deterioration in the performance of the borrowers, and it will increase to the default rate. That is what the default rate, increase in the default rate is estimated with evidence in the survey. Before forbearance policy that was introduced in 2008, the average rate of default rate was only 6%. But after this forbearance policy that was introduced in 2008, the proportion of default rate, the proportion of defaulters increased tremendously. There is an unprecedented increase in the proportion of defaulters. In this forbearance policy, the 7 years of forbearance, there was 51% increase in the defaulters compared to this pre-forbearance policy. There was 51%. So the survey exactly predicted this increase in the number of defaulters. So what the survey trying to say is, if you keep on using this forbearance policy like a staple diet for prolonged period rather than a method of emergency medicine, there will not be any utilization of this policy. Rather, it is threat to the healthy growth of banking industry because of tremendous rise in the defaulters. So the survey also tries to estimate the adverse impact of the forbearance policy with the asset quality review, with the evidence from the asset quality review. That is what discussed in the bank cleanup without adequate capital. Asset quality review identifies the stressful assets or the stressed assets or NPAs in the banking industry, and it, after thoroughly analyzing the situation of NPAs or stressed assets in the banking industry, and the RBI suggests to get rid of these stressed assets and doubtful assets to clean up their bank account books, So in this asset quality review, RBI missed the exact position of NPAs because of the forbearance policy. That's what discussed in this chapter. And this also in the that is what discussed in this bank cleanup without adequate capital heading, in this heading, it is also discussed that the AQR, asset quality review of RBI, is different from the AQR done in the other countries, maybe the developed countries. So the adverse, what AQR was done in India based on the presumption that the capital requirement in the banking industry will be taken care by the market. RBI presumes that the capital market-based capital infusion into the banking industry. Whatever capital required for the to meet the challenge of undercapitalization in the banking industry because of forbearance will be taken by care by the market. So because of this presumption and because of the forbearance, RBI was not able to fully and exactly efficiently identify the position of the NPAs, position of the substandard assets. And if you do not identify the position of NPAs and you suggest to clean up the bank books without adequate capital, it will be leading to the deterioration of the performance of the bank. It will lead to the deterioration of the performance of the banks. It is not a good measure. So inadequate cleanup of banks' balance sheets. So this AQR exercise was significantly underestimated the position of NPAs, the value of NPAs, the value of substandard assets. So it will lead to the evergreening. So if we keep on cleaning up banks without adequate capital, it will lead to the evergreening of loans. And this evergreening of loans will induce the phenomenon of undercapital. It will induce the phenomenon of undercapitalization as identified the Pigeon Eye Committee. How? Let's take the example that is discussed in this chapter. The very first year of introduction of AQR, the capital required, the AQR identified the required capital was to meet for the healthy growth of banking industry was 25,000 crores. It underestimated the capital requirement. But in the very next year, it estimated 45,000 crores. But what happened that after that? In 2017-18, after 2017-18 till today, Government of India is forced to infuse capital 2.11 lakh crores into the banking industries. So ultimately, it shifted the risk, it shifted the burden from the equity holders to the taxpayers, equity holders to the depositors. The Government of India has to infuse this much of money into the banking industry because of the forbearance, because of the underestimation of the capital requirement, because of the evergreening of loans, isn't it? So this cleaning up exercise should be accompanied by the this cleaning exercise without adequate capital will have a adverse impact on the lending, as the banks are unable to raise adequate capital after cleanup. It will obviously lending will be reduced. This will lead to the twin balance sheet syndrome. The balance sheets of the banks and as balance sheets of the corporate sector are getting suffered, isn't it? Corporates are not able to get adequate profits because of the stalled projects. Suppose if to increase the activity in the stalled projects, they have to get money from the banks. But banks are not able to lend more because banks are suffering from undercapitalization, because cleaning up has taken place without sufficient capital. So there will not be aggressive lending, or at least required lending to the corporate. So what will lead to the prolongation of twin balance sheet syndrome. This twin balance sheet syndrome maintains the stagnation in the economy for longer period, isn't it? So cleaning up, AQR's cleaning up without adequate will lead adverse impact on the lending practices and also declining the firm's capital investment. Like I said, firms more exposed to these AQR affected banks could not entirely replace their capital requirement. They need to go to for other other capital, other financial institutions also. They need to go to other form, other financial institutions also to meet their capital requirements. So this forbearance policy will also extend the, will also prolong the twin balance sheet syndrome, the capital constrained corporate houses, isn't it? So the survey also discuss the reforms needed for the getting rid of for the gradual residence of the forbearance policy, for the gradual introduction of reforms in the banking industry to remove the effects of regulatory forbearance, to remove the phenomena of regulatory forbearance. So what could be the policies? What type of policy implications should be adopted? What type of reforms should be adopted? It should not be a sudden phenomena. It should be a gradual phenomena. It should be a calibrated phenomena, isn't it? So whatever reforms you are going to introduce, that should be informed to the banks in advance. That should be informed to the banks in advance. So that there will be a policymaker should live with, there will be a threshold economic recovery. So banks will take sufficient precautions or suitable measures to gradually get rid of this effects of the forbearance policy, and also adopt the policies introduced by the policies or reforms introduced by the government of India or policymakers. So whatever policy should lay out a scientific mechanism or clear-cut mechanism for the cleanup of banks. And this cleanup of banks balance sheet necessary for this forbearance to be discontinued. So before forbearance is discontinued, this cleanup of banks should be introduced with utmost care. And this cleanup of bank balance should be accompanied with the infusion of adequate capital into the banking industries. It should be accompanied by the sufficient capital infusion into the banking industry. Along with that, the cleaning up of the discontinuation of forbearance policy should also introduce the reforms in the governance practices in the banking industry. Like as identified by the PGNI committee, there was a dire necessity for reforms in the work governance and the governance and corporate working of board of directors in the banking industries. There should be introduction of capable boards before getting rid of or before discontinuation of this forbearance policy. Like, otherwise it will lead to the distortion of the capital introduced into the banking industry. So there will be the inefficient bank boards, inefficient corporate boards, incapable boards, bank boards will have the chances of inefficient utilization of the capital introduced after cleaning up of the bank balance sheet, after discontinuation of the forbearance policy. Inefficient bank boards will discontinue this policy invisibly, the forbearance policy. So to remove that also, we should introduce an efficient bank boards, efficient bank practices, governance practices in the banking industry. Like legal infrastructure, already we have a strong legal infrastructure in the form of insolvency and bankruptcy code, and in the form of asset reconstruction companies, in the form of debt recovery tribunals, in the form of national company law tribunal and appellate tribunal. So these should be strengthened for introducing reforms for discontinuing forbearance policy, so that there will be a smooth recovery of loans in the banking industry, smooth exit of corporate houses from their business. So all this is discussed is also a continuation of some of the difficulties faced in the exit because of the stagnation in the banking industry also, that was discussed in the earlier economic surveys. So India is supposed to become the 5 trillion economy by 2024-25, and it is already fifth largest economy and third largest economy in terms of purchasing power parity, and it is on the way to, it is supposed to become one of the largest economy by 2041. So to reach the target, we should have a thriving and most efficient working banking industry and corporate houses, and we should get rid of the thin balance sheet syndrome. To do that, we should go for early resolution of the stressed assets, and we should not extend the forbearance policy. The forbearance policy should be utilized in future if there is any situation if there is any requirement. Forbearance policy should use as an emergency measure and should not be a staple diet. As I said in the outset of the survey, outside of this chapter, we should learn from the history. Otherwise, we are condemned to repeat it. Thank you very much.